Hi there, today on Typical Books, we're going to be talking about some of the new books coming out for April, May, maybe June. I don't know, it's been a while since I've done one of these. So yes, new books coming out to terrorize your very soul. So yeah, there's been a lot of really fantastic books being set up for the spring and into summer, and some really big names. We have some new Stephen King. We have new Joyce Carol Oates. We have all sorts of really cool big names and new names peppered in between. So without further ado, we're gonna pop on over to typicalbooks.com/newbooks or new horror. I think that's what it is. The link will be below. The Ghost of Ravenwood Hall, which is a cover I've seen quite a bit. When William Gare's estranged father dies under mysterious circumstances and makes a heinous accusation against him, Will must journey to a place that has haunted him since childhood, a place he vowed to never return, Ravenswood Hall. I love the name of that. That sounds really good. Memories of the past are the least of Will's troubles. Stories of murder and witchcraft hinder Will's efforts to settle the estate and clear his name, and at the heart of it all is a Spanish painter named Leonora Laveau. Okay, got some voodoo kind of feels going on with that, and some Edgar Allan Poe kind of nods in that name alone. Now a fixture in this crumbling hall, she claims to have witnessed Will's father leap from the widow's walk in the throes of lunacy. Rumors in town tell a darker side, that she drove him to it. Okay, I'm sold. That's very interesting. Everything about it, from the name of the hall to Leonora Laveau. That's kind of cool. Will could be anybody. The Thing in the Wind by Bill Mullen. Okay, if I had to choose just between these books alone, I think I would choose this one because it's a Canadian sort of book. A search party stumbles upon unspeakable horror that threatens both lives and sanity. In the heart of the Canadian wilderness, a harrowing tale of survival and psychological horror unfolds in this gripping novel. That's not part of the summary, people. That shouldn't be on the back of the book. It doesn't tell you anything about it. It doesn't make me want to buy it that you think it's a gripping tale. My gosh. Sorry, rant over. Amidst the vast, unforgiving landscape, a woman's world is shattered by the mysterious disappearance of her mother in the remote reaches of northern Saskatchewan. Along with her father and a small determined search party, she embarks on a desperate quest for answers, only to encounter an unspeakable horror lurking in the shadows of the ancient forest. Not enough horror comes out of Saskatchewan. Not enough anything comes out of Saskatchewan, it seems. So I'm quite interested in hearing more about the Forgotten Province. Yeah, very intrigued. I like the sound of this. That was The Thing in the Wind by Bill Mullen. It comes out April 1st, as did Ravenswood Hall. April 2nd. I know that these have already come out, and everyone's heard quite a lot about All the Fiends of Hell by Adam Neville. Seeing the morning is no blessing. The handful of scattered survivors are confronted by blood-red skies and an infestation of predatory horrors that never originated on Earth. An occupying force intent on erasing the remnants of animal life on this planet. That's scary. No wonder people are enjoying this one so much. Across the deserted landscapes of England, bereft of infrastructure and society, the overlooked can either hide or try to outrun the infernal hunting terrors, until a rumor emerges claiming that the sea may offer an escape. Interesting. You know, up until now, I didn't really know what that was about because I was skipping reviews of it so that I could read it in peace someday and find out about it myself, but there we are. Cranberry Cove by Hayley Piper. Hayley Piper fans rejoice. What's been happening at Cranberry Cove? It's unspeakable. It's unspoken. Umberlee Hale is about to take a dark journey inside the derelict hotel and inside her own past to find out the horrible truth. I'm intrigued. There's an escape room horror coming out also on April 2nd called No Escape by Maureen Stoffels. And it says, Lexi receives an invitation to participate in a brand new escape room. Along with her best friend Tess, she's thrilled. They could both use the distraction after a recent tragedy. But once inside, they learn that they must compete against one another. I like escape rooms. I've never really participated in one, but I've seen like the inside of one and the inner workings of them, and I've heard all about them. Maybe I should just read this book. Also on April 2nd, we have Only the Dead by R.W. Duder. Dive into a slasher anthology that explores the transformation of men into monsters amidst the horrors of war. Innocence clashes with darkness, and survival becomes a desperate struggle of the will. Okay. Innocence clashes with darkness, and survival becomes a desperate struggle against evil. Okay, short and sweet. Only the Dead, an anthology of August 2nd. It says anthology, but I think it may be a collection because it lists only the one author. We have an anthology, Horror Writers for Climate Action, and it's called Revelations. And it features quite a few authors. Nunzo Ono, Clive Barker, Stephen King, Gwendolyn Kice, Paul Tremblay, and many others, it says. So it is Horror Writers for Climate Action. Also on April 2nd, Someone You Can Build a Nest In by John Wiswell. Sheshishin is a shapeshifter that lives happily in an amorphous lump at the bottom of a ruined manor. When her rest is interrupted by hunters intent on murdering her, she constructs a body from the remains of past meals, a metal chain for a backbone, borrowed bones for limbs, and a bear trap for an extra mouth. An extra mouth. Someone You Can Build a Nest In. I just like the title. Getting better as a society at titling horror novels. The Black Girl Survives This One, Horror Stories, edited by Desiree S. Evans and Saraycha J. Fennell. Celebrating a new generation of best-selling and acclaimed Black writers, The Black Girl Survives in This One makes space for Black girls in horror. 15 chilling and thought-provoking stories place Black girls front and center as heroes and survivors who slay monsters, battle spirits, and face down death. Okay, very interesting. I love the cover of that one as well. We're going to skip some April 2nd because there's so much. Up to This Skin Was Once Mine and Other Disturbances by Eric LaRocca. A brand new collection of four intense, claustrophobic, and terrifying horror tales from the Bram Stoker Award-nominated and Splatterpunk Award-winning author of Things Have Gotten Worse Since We Last Spoke. Good title sometimes. Interesting covers. People are ripping off this sort of titling and cover combination. And it's unsettling to me to a certain degree because it doesn't always work. It doesn't always work. It doesn't always work for the masters of it either. But This Skin Was Once Mine and Other Disturbances. I like that. I'm interested in This Skin Was Once Mine, the title story. There's other stories called Seedling, All the Parts of You That Won't Easily Burn, and Prickle. A one-word title from Eric LaRocca. I am here for it, as the kids say. On April 9th, we have Ghost Station by S.A. Barnes. An abandoned plant, a hidden past, and a deadly danger. I've always disliked those sorts of like Gatling gun descriptions at the beginning of summaries, and often I just don't put them in. Same with when they're talking like that earlier novel about what a harrowing good read it is. It's like, yes, tell me about the story, not that you think it is such a fantastic novel. Psychologist Dr. Ophelia Bray has dedicated her life to the study and preservation of ERS, the most famous case of which resulted in a brutal murder of 29 people. It's personal to her, and when she's assigned to a small exploration crew who recently suffered the tragic death of a colleague, she wants to help. But as they begin to establish residency on an abandoned planet, it becomes clear that the crew is hiding something. So yeah, if you like space horror, we don't get enough of it, then Ghost Station is for you. Grey Dog by Elliot Gish, which I did receive a review copy of. It's sitting back here. There is a review on my channel for it as well. The year is 1901 and Ada Bird, spinster, schoolmarm, amateur naturalist, accepts a teaching post in the isolated Lowry Bridge. Grateful for the chance to reestablish herself where no one knows her secrets. She develops friendships with her neighbors, explores the woods with her students, and begins to see the future in this tiny farming community. Her past, riddled with grief and shame, has never seemed so far away. She begins to witness strange phenomena, a swarm of dying crickets, a self-mutilating rabbit, and a malformed fawn. And she soon believes that something old and beastly, which she calls the Grey Dog, is behind these visceral offerings. And I'll leave it there because the description goes on, but fantastic book. If you're interested in a review, I have one here as well. Myrrh by Polly Hull. Myrrh has a goblin inside her, a voice in her head that tells her all the things she's done wrong, that berates her and drags her down, desperately searching for her birth parents. Across dilapidated seaside towns in the south coast of England, she finds herself silenced and cut off at every step. Also on April 9th, we have The Gathering, a novel by C.J. Tudor. In a small Alaska town, a boy is found with his throat ripped out and the blood drained from his body. The inhabitants of Dead Heart haven't seen a killing like this in 25 years. But they know who's responsible, a member of the colony, an ostracized community of vampires living in an old mine settlement deep in the woods. So if you miss 30 Days of Night, like I do, then The Gathering by C.J. Tudor may be for you. Now, if you want something darker still, we have a little bit of extreme or splatterpunk horror for you in Evil Little Fucks by Sinister Smile Press. Behind the facade of sweetness and light, there lurks a darkness that defies comprehension as the veil of innocence is cruelly stripped away to reveal something far more sinister. Journey through the twisted minds of evil children. So it's an evil child anthology in splatterpunk or extreme fashion. So the kids probably live in that one. There was a conversation on Reddit recently about what you don't like in horror, what makes you put it down. And some people were talking about torture of children, of course, is something no one wants to read about. But interestingly, they find in extreme and splatterpunk, the children typically make it out alive and fairly unscathed. Very interesting. Also on the 12th, we have Unholy Trinity, The Unholy Trinity by L. Murray Wood. Dive into the terrifying worlds of L. Murray Wood. These stories range from quiet horror, hinting at the things buried there in your psyche, the thing that will come out to play after dark, and visceral horror that leaves no doubt what lies in a bloody heap in the middle of the floor. Fun stuff. On April 15th, we have The Count by David Jack Fletcher. When Sam's ex, Danny, winds up gutted beyond recognition, Sam has no memory of where he was at the time. He can only remember the strange comfort of his new house. The endless ticking of the clock he can't find. The bloody knife he woke up holding in the morning that Danny was killed. Sam's guilt over Danny is undercut by the endless ticking, a growing desire to drink from the dead, and an anonymous GPS pings that lead him to corpses. The stench of them rotting makes him hungry. So something has changed in Sam's world. The Count by David Jack Fletcher. Sounds very interesting. I love the cover. We have Indian Burial Ground by Nick Medina. This was on the patron pick as well, which did not win. What did win is The Haunting of Velkwood by Gwendolyn Keist, so I will be reading that very, very soon. That came out last month. So Indian Burial Ground. All Naomi wanted was a fresh start with a new boyfriend who actually treats her right and a plan to move from the reservation she grew up on, just like her beloved Uncle Louie before her. Things are finally looking up for Naomi. Until the news of her boyfriend's apparent suicide brings her world crumbling down. But the facts about Roddy's death just don't add up, and Naomi isn't the only one who suspects that something menacing may be lurking on their tribal lands. That sounds scary to me, and that's why it was on my list. This one I hadn't seen, though. Lord of the Feast by Tim Wagner. 20 years ago, a cult attempted to create their own god, the Lord of the Feast. The god was horrible, a misbegotten thing. However, the cultists killed their creature before it could come to its full power. The cultists trapped the pieces of their god inside mystic night stones and then went their separate ways. Okay, very intrigued. I did hear Tim Wagner speak last year at StokerCon, and I need to read more of his work. I just love hearing him talk. I like the way he teaches writing. Very interested to check that out. Also on the 16th, we have the other book I'll be reading from ECW Press, Withered, by A.G.A. Wilmot. After the tragic death of their father and surviving a life-threatening eating disorder, 18-year-old Alice moves back with their mother to the small town of Blackstone, seeking a simpler life and some more space to recover. But Blackstone feels off. It's a disquieting place surrounded by towns with some of the highest death rates in the county. Scary. It doesn't help that everyone says Alice's new house is haunted. Everyone, including Quinn, a local girl who has quickly captured Ellie's attention. So yeah, I'm interested in small town horror as ever. On May 2nd, we have some disturbing news. John Athen has published his first collection of short stories. I mentioned this on the patron-only podcast, Do Not Disturb, the first trilogy by John Athon. I've not read any John Athon. The Groomer, which is the book that everyone seems to know him by, did its rounds here on BookTube. A lot of people actually enjoyed it. It came with heavy trigger warnings. Did its rounds on BookTok, where people seem to dip into extreme horror where they're not really horror readers. But yeah, so I'm very intrigued. May 2nd. Inspired by the 2016 clown sightings, killer clowns wreak havoc across the globe on a night of simultaneous coordinated attacks. A motel in the middle of nowhere, Nevada, a new resort in the Las Vegas Strip, a remote village nestled deep in the Nevada desert. Nowhere and no one is safe on the night of killer clowns. Do Not Disturb, the first trilogy. That is clown horror? Written by John Athon? I'm very interested. On May 14th, we have something that reminds me of The Bell Witch, the body in the tree. It is Cinder Witch by Cherry Priest. Decades after trespassing children spotted a desiccated corpse wedged in the treetop, no one knows the answer. Kate and her former college professor, Dr. Judith Kane, travel to Cinder Witch, Tennessee, in hopes that maybe it was their Ellen, Katie's lost aunt and Judith's long-lost lover, but they're not the only ones to have come here looking for closure. The people of Cinder Witch, a town hardly more than a skeleton itself, are staunchly resistant to the outsider's questions about Ellen and her killer. And the deeper the two women dig, the more they unearth and the closer they come to exhuming the evil that lies hungering at the roots of Cinder Witch. I would like to live in a town called Cinder Witch. I think that's a perfect name for a town. We have a couple other things coming out May 14th. The House That Horror Built by Christina Henry catches my eye to a certain extent. There's quite a lot of like horror movie inspired horror coming up this summer, and that is just one of them. About a girl, Harry Adams is her name. I love that. That moves in to care for an aging movie director called Javier Castillo. And he has a forbidding Chicago mansion. She moves in. It's called Bright Horses, which made me laugh because I thought of Goodbye Horses for whatever reason. And it's filled from top to bottom with props and memorabilia. And he has been cloistered in there when a tragedy drove him to vanish from the industry. I don't see where the horror lies. I have to read more about that book, but the cover looks horrific and it is like a theme that's happening. Coming up in horror for whatever reason. On May 21st, we have Butcher, a novel by Joyce Carol Oates. In a harrowing story based on the authentic historical documents, we follow the career of Dr. Silas Weir, father of gynopsychiatry, as he ascends from professional anonymity to national renown. Humiliated by a procedure gone terribly wrong, Weir is forced to take a position in New Jersey Asylum for Female Lunatics. And that was probably the exact name of it, the Asylum for Female Lunatics, where he reigns. There he is allowed to continue his practice unchecked for decades, making a name for himself by focusing on women who have been neglected by the state, women he subjects to the most grotesque modes of experimentalism. I'm very, very wary and very, very scared already. I think this will be a very uncomfortable body horror from Joyce Carol Oates, who writes horror just deliciously and terrifyingly with such socio-political aplomb that I am very much looking forward to this book from Joyce Carol Oates coming out May 21st. One to watch. Also on the same day, we have a Stephen King book. You Like It Darker, Stories by Stephen King. You like it darker? Fine, then so do I, says Stephen King in the afterword to this magnificent new collection of 12 stories. Okay, tell us again how it's magnificent. 12 stories that delve into the darker parts of life, both metaphorical and literal. King has, for half a century, been the master of the form, and these stories about fate, mortality, luck, and the folds of reality, where anything can happen, are as rich and riveting as his novels, both weighty in theme and a huge pleasure to read. Okay, tell us again how it's a pleasure to read Stephen King. We all already know that, and we already know he's a legendary storyteller, but apparently these are fantastic, and I don't doubt it. A lot of people have waited for him to really grab hold of what he had captured our hearts with, and I think this might touch on some of that. So, You Like It Darker, Stories by Stephen King, coming May 21st. Perfect summer reading timing, too. On May 28th, we have The Cannibal, which is something I'm looking forward to, by Louise Flaherty and Solomon Awa. Based on an Inuit traditional story passed down orally for generations, The Cannibal tells the horrific tale of a family experiencing starvation when the animals they rely on for survival disappear. While the wife stays alive by eating plants she gathers daily, the husband does the unthinkable, resorting to murder and cannibalism. Horrified and terrified for her life, the wife eventually finds herself alone in camp with her husband. She knows what will happen to her if she does not find a way to escape. Hatching a plan, the exhausted wife embarks on a journey with her murderous husband in pursuit. Now that sounds fantastic. Inuit stories don't typically make it to the mainstream because they do rely on oral storytelling, and stories are usually guarded by the storytellers in the community. And this must be based on one of those. It's very similar to the Wendigo story, right? So yeah, very much looking forward to The Cannibal. And that will round out April and May with a teaser to come in June, Small Town Horror by Ronald Malfi. I've only read The Snow, I believe, by Ronald Malfi, and I really enjoyed it. He's got that sort of 80s schlock thing down pat, and I really enjoy his work. He's a really good writer. So another small town story, though, very interested in this. Andrew Larimer has left his past behind. Rising up the ranks in a New York law firm with a heavily pregnant wife, he is settling into a new life far from Kingsport, the town in which he grew up. But when he receives a late night phone call from an old friend, like you do, he has no chance but to return home. Of course. I come from a small town, so I'm always just like, oh, here we go. Something's gonna go wrong. Coming home means returning to his late father's house, where he has seen better days. It means lying to his wife, but it also means reuniting with old friends. Eric, now the town's sheriff, Dale, a real estate mogul living in the shadow of a failed career, his childhood sweetheart, Tig, who could never escape town, and poor Meech, whose ravings about a curse upon the group have driven him to drugs and alcohol. I am very interested in Small Town Horror by Ronald Malfi, and I would say it's going to be on the next patron pick poll, but I think I'm just going to haul off and buy that entirely and leave other books coming up into June for the next poll. So yeah, if you'd like to vote on that, you can join the Bookworms over on Patreon. And of course, if you're just interested in supporting, all these books that I've talked about and more are on typicalbooks.com, and the links that I list there are affiliate links, so you can follow them to Amazon, buy the book, and I get a small commission from that. And I also get to see what books people pick up based on my recommendations, which is super cool because they track all that. And not only books, if you buy other stuff, like you use the link to go to Amazon and then buy other stuff. So I've seen other people buy like AirPods or camera equipment because they're also booktubers. But yeah, I digress. That is all of the books that I thought caught my eye for April and May, and Ronald Malfi's fantastic sounding Small Town Horror coming out in June. Have you read any of these books, or are any of them already on your list too? Let me know in the comments, and thank you very much for watching. Have an ooky, spooky day.